This is a monstrously big insect. It's a female dobsonfly. In its aquatic larval form, this insect is often called a helgramite. But here, as an adult with its giant wings and long, flexible body, I think it's about as dragon-like in appearance as an insect can get. Dobsonflies belong to an order of insects called Megaloptera, named that because of their huge wings. In that order, the closest thing to them is what you see here, a fishfly. Fishflies are in the same order and family as dobsonflies, and are like them in a lot of ways. Most of their lives are lived in the water as predatory larval insects. Once they get to this stage, they're at the tail end of their life, living only a few weeks or so and feeding rarely, if even at all. To get a sense of how similar these two insects can be, in this scene you're seeing a female dobsonfly on the left compared to a female fishfly on the right. Slight anatomical differences like the size of their jaws and the shapes of their antennal segments make them distinguishable, but as you're seeing right now, the adult flight behavior between these two insects is a very close match. The only other group of insects in the Megalopteran order are these, alderflies. Like the last two, the larval stage of alderflies are aquatic, so if you're lucky enough to see an adult like this, you're probably near the water source it grew up in. Worldwide, there are only 100 species of alderfly, and with only a few hundred more species of dobsonflies and fishflies, that makes Megaloptera one of the smallest orders of insects. For this video, I put together a collection of insects and flight sequences I think are a little odd. For all these clips, they either show something really interesting or are insects I haven't seen captured in flight before. Take, for instance, this one. This is an owlfly. Owlflies look kind of like damselflies or dragonflies, but they're neuropterans closely related to things like antlions and lacewing insects. This one would only move in front of my camera if I brushed it into action with a little paintbrush. That's because at rest, they spend their time hanging out on vegetation like this, probably trying to blend in as a twig or camouflage themselves while being more or less in plain sight. Here's this one taking off after being brushed from that resting position. Some things to notice here are the clubbed butterfly-like antennae, which are a feature of all owlflies, the giant eyes, which are useful if you're chasing down other flying insects as prey, and their impressive tarsal claws at the end of each leg, probably really useful for grabbing and holding onto something that's trying to fly away. The next insect is a common one, but one that you don't see flying around too often. These are termites. Termites fly at particular times in the year to congregate, mate, and disperse to start a new colony. They come out in huge numbers and drop their wings after they fly, so sometimes you just see a bunch of shiny wings on the ground the morning after a flight, but no termites in sight. Compared to their bodies, their wings are huge. Termites are a derived form of a social roach, and their wings do resemble the front wings of many roach species. But while roaches have a larger and folded hind wing, the termites' wings are flat and uncomplicated. Okay, now for some interesting beetle behaviors. This is a net-winged beetle. It raises its protective front wings in preparation for a flight, then the legs come up as it pushes off the ground, but it forgets to fly. This one never flaps its hind wings and just tumbles over onto the ground. It's like all the steps before wing flapping happened, but then things just stop and flight never happens. Besides being kind of funny, it is informative to see this happen because you get to see how much the legs and jumping are tied to flight behavior. This one gets some good momentum going by standing and doing a little hind leg powered jump, but the whole body only gets a couple millimeters off the ground. From there, normally wing flapping would be happening fast enough to continue lifting the beetle up and off the ground. For comparison, here's a different species of net-winged beetle doing a better job flying. For this one, while it's using the legs to stand and hop, it's also flapping the wings and gets four flaps in before the hind legs are up off the ground. You might have also noticed that this beetle has a long snout with finger-like projections sticking off of it. Those are sticky masses of pollen called pollinia that this beetle picked up from rooting around on milkweed. Both this beetle and the other net-winged beetle were hanging out on a patch of milkweed in southeastern Arizona. I was there for a macro photography workshop called Bugshot, which, if you're interested in learning and practicing insect photography, is a field workshop I highly recommend checking out. The next beetle with some interesting behavioral quirks is this one, a click beetle. Now, click beetles, of course, are famous for their clicking behavior, which is when they use a spring system to quickly flex their thorax, which throws them off their backs and up into the air. They're also pretty good at flying too. In fact, when I usually come across a click beetle, it's either flown to a light or is up off the ground, hanging out on leaves or on the bark of a tree. The best part about this particular one is this. This pale spot on the thorax is a light-producing organ. These click beetles are bioluminescent. Here's what their spooky green glow looks like when they scurry around on the ground. The light they produce is pretty bright, and they'll do it when they're disturbed like this one does when I gently grab a hold of it. Click beetles are closely related to fireflies, and they use the same molecules and enzymes to produce their light, but the two groups likely evolve light production independent of each other. Next is one of North America's most attractive beetles, a leaf beetle called the dogbane beetle. It's called that because dogbane is a plant that both the adults and larvae specialize on. It's a native plant that's toxic to vertebrates, but is host to this beetle and several species of moths that have figured out how to use it as a food source. These adult dogbane beetles are shockingly iridescent. The whole body, from the legs to the undersides of their abdomen, have a metallic shimmering green, while the top sides of their forewings shine with reds and yellows. The bright colors might serve as a warning signal to potential predators, advertising some of the toxic compounds and distastefulness these beetles pick up from their host plant. Continuing on the theme of extraordinary insect colors, this is a green horsefly, and in the background of this shot is the tip of my index finger to give you some scale for how huge it is. Horseflies like this consume plant pollen and nectar, but also females are blood feeders, requiring blood as a protein-rich food to aid in egg development. When this one lifts off, watch closely to the body right behind the front wings and you'll see the halter, which is the hind wing that has been modified into a flapping gyroscope. A much more common version of green color in flies is the iridescent green you're seeing here on the fly on the left, which is similar to the dogbane beetle you saw just before this. The more flat, pigmented green that the horsefly has is pretty unique among flies. In fact, of the hundreds of horsefly species in the US, this is the only one that looks like this. This is a stilt-legged fly. Believe it or not, this fly is a wasp mimic. But instead of being shape-like or having an overall body color scheme like a wasp, what it does to mimic them is mostly through behavior. They hang out on leaves and stick their white-tipped front legs out in front of their bodies. As they walk around, they rapidly vibrate their legs to mimic the constant sweeping motion that a wasp would be doing with their antennae. In flight, they seem more fly-like than wasp-like to me, though it does look like they still hold their front legs forward. Maybe they're trying to mimic wasp antennae when they fly, too. These last two clips I wouldn't normally include in a video because these shots aren't quite good enough for me, but I had to put these here because they definitely fit the oddball theme of this video. These are two aquatic insects. On the left is a back swimmer, and on the right is a water boatman. They can hardly stand or walk, but they do fly. In fact, both of these flew to a light trap I had set up. To get off the ground, they use one powerful swing of their paddle-like hind legs to launch themselves into the air. That's the same motion they'd be normally using to swim, so it's interesting to see them use it here to start their flights too. Okay, and that's it for now. Thanks for watching.